Very rare.
I didn't ever made any MGs with the 6 months.
Hey, everybody, my name is, for those of you that don't know me, my name is Grace Agnew, and I'm an associate university librarian for digital library systems and records. And I was asked to come today to talk to you about what I think is a very significant new service that Rutgers Libraries is getting ready to roll out, and that's our institutional repository, the RU Core. So, what is RU Core? Well, it is, as I say, an institutional repository, which is essentially, just what the name might indicate, it's a digital place to preserve, manage, and make available the research and publications from the university, its faculty, and any of their collaborators. It's also our cyber infrastructure in the libraries, the way that we will make available our significant collections and other anything else in digital form that we want to share with the community. So what's the intent of RU Core? Well, one of our goals is to provide seamless, perpetual access to digital information, our resources and resources belonging to faculty and administrators at Rutgers. It's also a flexible framework of core capabilities that provide our enabling infrastructure and also interoperability with everything else that's going on via the web and sustainability. And finally, it's a way for us to offer, I hope, intelligent and useful access to the wealth of multidisciplinary information. Both the information that we're storing in our repository and the information that's available in other repositories. So why create it now? It's a very ambitious agenda for us. Of course, we're all aware of where the budget is and things like that. And the budget's not been great for several years. But we think that we've reached that kind of critical storm of the intersection of what the cyber infrastructure is capable of and what Rutgers' needs are. I came to Rutgers from Georgia Tech, and Georgia Tech was a fairly homogenous, small environment. When I was interviewing at Rutgers, I did what a lot of people do, a standard activity. I browsed the Rutgers website. And it was clear to me as a digital librarian, that what you saw at Rutgers was an absolute forest of intellectual stovepipes. I mean, even more than you'd see at a place like Georgia Tech, where the focus is strictly on engineering and different aspects of engineering. I mean, Rutgers is a, complete arts, sciences, technology, etc. community, and I came to discover the whole New Jersey culture is one of home rule, stovepipe, I do it my way, you do it your way, and I don't think it's a coincidence that one of the most famous songs from Frank Sinatra, the Hoboken Days, was My Way. So, as someone looking at you guys from the outside, I can say New Jersey, the entire New Jersey in its own way, is a bunch of really interesting stovepipes. We also, as I said, had the technologies that we needed to create what's known as a sort of trusted repository, an architecture that makes information accessible for the long term. And to really understand what the library world means about trusted repository, what you have to understand is that in a digital repository, what you're getting is you're getting the white gloves, handle, things with care, encase them in Mylar, keep it for 200 years world, bumping up with a smack against the digital environment and asking of the digital environment what they've been able to do in the analog environment, which is say this information will be around in 200 years. That's actually a very tough statement to make in the digital environment, but the library world is working very hard toward trying to meet the gold standard of the analog environment, which is in 200 years. This information ought to be accessible and useful. I mean, those of you that are working on digital projects, think about your own projects. Some of them may be grant funded. You're looking toward the end of that grant, turning in a good report, writing the next grant. Have you thought the long term about will it be available in 200 years? If you think that way, it's a very daunting idea. However, granting agencies are now starting, as you've probably seen, to require this permanent sustained access to research projects. This is also a natural extension of the library's role in the university. I mean, that's what we've always been about, is preserving and making accessible information. We're just taking our role a couple of giant steps further by proposing ourselves as a core infrastructure for all the digital publications that you guys are creating and not just the ones that we purchase or own ourselves. So what are our focus areas? Well, preservation is a key focus area. making resources available for the long term and trying to answer in the affirmative the question to the scholars access to information in 200 years. We also want to support the tremendous amount of publishing that goes on in the university, sustained publishing models that have done very well in analog form into the digital environment. We have an e-journal platform, for example, that supports peer-reviewed e-journals. We're working on electronic theses and dissertations. We also want to provide collections that are of lasting value to scholars and have an impact on people's research and teaching. And we want particularly to support the university's twin missions of research and teaching and try to integrate RU4 into your workflow so that you hardly know it's there, but you trust that your resources will be available and accessible for the long term. So, what does a trusted repository architecture require? Well, it requires that a digital object be authentic, and I'll talk about what that means in the digital space in a minute. That the digital object be uniquely identified so that it can be shared out there and it can go out in the world and be available on the World Wide Web. But that authentic object and no other is what somebody's going to retrieve when they want to use that information. And also it means that there's metadata, or data about data that supports the management, discovery, and reuse of information. So that's the preservation component, building that trusted repository architecture. So what does authenticity mean? Well, it means integrity, that the digital document that's placed with us must remain whole and undisturbed. And it also means that there's provenance attached to it. We know where it came from. We know how it's been used. We know if it's been reused and modified. We know that you're able to trust and see a digital audit trail that the object you deposited with us has either not changed or it's changed in very specific ways that you've authorized, such as a data curation model that says, well, we've normalized this data. You know, we've changed the way the blank spaces were used. We've done this, we've done that, we've peer reviewed it. So it has been changed, but we can go back to the original objects and we can trace it through all of its instantiations of change. In the analog space, what it also means is that it has always meant is that the object in hand might be compared with conceptual or canonical historical version. And why is that the case? Well, because anything in the analog world deteriorates. We see ourselves deteriorating. A friend of mine once commented that when she hit 50, all of the warranties expired, and now she's in the shop constantly. Well, that happens with objects as well. I mean, if you're a museum curator, you know that you're constantly having to do repairs, you're having to accommodate problems, etc. A famous classic example is the Venus de Milo. At some point in Venus de Milo's history, the arms were damaged. And it was after that point that people started writing about, assessing the historical value, etc. of the Venus de Milo. We really don't have a history of Venus de Milo with arms. Well, technology exists today that you could recreate that digitally and you could add arms and they would be indistinguishable and you could probably mimic the sculptor's talent and skill, but that would not be the canonical version. The canonical version is what exists in analog form and that is the Venus de Milo without arms. So canonical is an important concept and I'll talk about that in a minute. So in the digital space, what do we mean by authenticity? Well, if we're talking about something that had an original analog form, it's fidelity to that source artifact, that nothing really has been changed, that the maximum amount of information is carried over into the digital form. That's really critical when you're digitizing a photograph or a video. It also means that, that whenever you look at it, you can do a true-false comparison. The thing that was deposited with me, that has the provenance attached, that this is what I deposited, has not changed, and that's true or false. It's not, well, it's changed slightly, it's changed in good ways. For it to be authentic, it has not changed. It also, and that's to the digital canonical master, which I'll talk about in a minute. And it also means it's accompanied by that true provenance statement. Here's when we received it, here's what we were supposed to have received. This is identical to the manifest of what someone said we were supposed to receive. And we do that within our Fedora repository by attaching a digital signature to everything that comes in, and also through metadata, which documents both provenance and preservation events. So we document every event. Some of it we have to hand create, some of it is automatically documented, but we document every event in the life cycle of an object. So you know every event that happens to that object. And if it's changed, you know why it's changed and when. But the original canonical source is still available. So what is a canonical source in the digital space? In the digital space, a canonical source will be one that's faithful to the information as the researcher or creator intended it to be, but it's transparent to applications. So for example, an electronic thesis or dissertation that's created in Word would not be the canonical source, because if anybody that's used Word knows, Microsoft is very bad about being backward compatible with Word. So sooner or later, that object would be unable to be opened, and it's certainly not going to be available 200 years from now. But if we use like an OpenXML or an RTF, which is also a standard, an international standard version that maintains all of the formatting, then we've got a canonical object, because we've got an object that is independent of the application of a commercial application that's needed to view it. So that's kind of how we interpret canonical source objects in the digital space. And I think you can see from that why it's a real challenge and a real hurdle to try and anticipate what an object needs to be in 200 years. Particularly since there won't be the web, there won't be computers, and whatever we're using will probably be embedded in your body in 200 years to gain information. Another thing that you want to have is you want to be able to share your information in its authentic, verifiably authentic form. And that requires that you have a globally unique identifier, a GUID. And we use a standard one here, and that's a handle. And that's part of our Fedora repository. So this provides durable access to a copy, so people can point to a copy, which in itself might move around, but the handle location never moves. So that you never get a 404 object not found, and you can actually point to the object rather than having to make copies of the object. To share something, for example, a piece of music from the music department with both the university repository and the international music portal. That's actually kind of important because one of my other areas of interest is I'm writing a book right now on digital rights management. And there's a major disconnect, as you probably already know, between what technology is capable of and where copyright law stands. So it's really rather important if we're going to be able to be honest and honorable about the rights that associate with the creator for objects, that we're able to monitor where the object goes and how it's used in a way that respects the privacy of the user. So, how do we maintain durability for future generations? Well, there's three standard methodologies for digital permanence. One is, we could preserve the digital mediation state. To go back to that thesis and dissertation, we could preserve the Windows environment, the Microsoft Word version, encapsulate all of that, and basically recreate that environment so you could view that thesis and dissertation. That's one way to try and preserve for 200 years. Another way is to emulate the digital mediation space, create some sort of universal viewer that can read every version of Microsoft Word that was ever written, but that can also take advantage of newer operating systems and newer technologies in the web. And the other way is to transcode or encode the information. A format goes away, or a format that provides better fidelity or better manipulation comes along. We need to be able to re-encode images from TIFF to a JPEG 2000, for example. So we can't choose one of these three, because every object is going to have its own inherent better practice for ensuring its long-term availability. We have to have a repository that lets us support all three, and that's what we've been working with our Fedora repository, working towards. So one way we do this is we capture technical metadata, both from the header of the object, and we capture it as settings that we set up when we digitize objects in a template, so that we know exactly how we created an object. We not only have provenance that tells us where it came from, what rights are associated with it, what its intended use was it produced for a grant, was it subsequently published in an article, who else has borrowed it and used it, and how. Not only do we document all of these provenance events in the life cycle of the resource, we also document how it was created, so that we can And we also document any digital changes that either happened in Berkeley or that we deliberately make happen to an object for data curation purposes. So we have technical metadata, we have provenance metadata, and we also have descriptive metadata to enable people to discover information. So metadata is a critical piece. We are a data-driven repository. And metadata is basically data about data. It only has meaning with respect to the object that it describes or manages, and it has to be flexible enough to support current and future information context for both discovery and management. And that's actually a very critical issue. This is our data model, and it's a very simple data model. I do a lot of consulting with large repositories. I'm consulting right now with San Diego Supercomputing Center, and with Disney, and with a couple of other places. And the common mistake that people make is they get very immersed. They ask all the right questions of their users. They identify their key user base. They call together focus groups. They know exactly how they want to use that information. And they develop elaborate data models to support that. And there are some inherent problems with doing that. What would you think some of those problems might be? Any ideas? Interactive here. Why would that be a problem? If you've done a really good job of identifying what your users need and you document every inch of that in metadata, why wouldn't that be tremendous?
Is it flexible to change?
If you it's, make that's it so part rigid? Of it. Part of it is it's not flexible to change. What else? Yes.
It's very subjective.
Right. Right.
It's subjective, that's my comment.
Exactly. It's also not multidisciplinary. The information that you're creating used to be exclusive to your community, and you'd share it among your community, but now on the web, who is your community? Social scientists are looking at science data. Scientists are looking at social science data to look at the social dimensions of pollution, for example. Data is inherently multidisciplinary, but the tools to discover them still are not. They're still subtype tools. We also had to have a very simple data model, because we needed to be able to support everything that you guys do. One of the projects I worked on not too long ago was the National Earthquake Engineering System, the NEES project. And I looked at their data model, the very duck Stanford. It was a very, very complex data model. And it was based on the idea, that a very commendable idea, that they wanted to work with the workflow of the user. So they were capturing information in a lab notebook implementation in a piece of software called Chef. And everything was done by experiments. So the experiment was the paradigm. So they would say, first, if you know the experiment, the project. If you know the project, you can discover the experiment, and then you can find the data that emerged from that experiment. Well, the trouble was that NEES was intended to enable people to do computational research. And computational research doesn't really think in the paradigm of projects and experiments. So people were having trouble finding the data. They also had boxed themselves in so that the data itself was not a primary part of the data model, but simply an end product of the project and the experiment. So there was a lot of flexibility in describing the project and the experiment, but not a whole lot for the data. Well, that data, combs its hair, brushes its teeth, and it goes out in the world. It shows up in an article, it gets reused in computation. A lot of things can happen to that data. There's no way in their data model to trace the life cycle of that data. So we broke it apart to look more like this RE4 data model, because our data model is very basic. It says that you have objects, you have agents who are both maybe defined within the data, say a biography or a photograph of a person, but they also create the data, and so they're rights holders, they're owners. They may use the data. You have places. These may be places where the object, an analog object, is stored. It may be a place where an object was created. Anytime any one of those, two of those three, intersect together in a date and time, you have an event. And events are ways that people do put information together. It's a non-contextual way. You can add your own context to an event. So we use the event because the event is sort of, it's context independent, it's discipline independent, and it enables the end user, whether it's a manager of a project or whether it's the person who's going to discover that information, to create their own context in the form of an event and find information. And thus far we found that we can pretty much map anything we need to do into this data model. As we broaden our metadata to a lot more use, it'll be interesting to see if it holds water, but I think it will, because it seems to be holding water in these and some other projects. So basically, what we build out is we build out a lot of different kinds of information that we need to manage your things for the long term, and you need to add context, because you can add that context. The context is important. Serving your immediate users is important. It's not done in the underlying data model, because that won't persist for 200 years. It won't persist for 5. It didn't persist for even a couple of years in these. But you can add that on, and we can add that on in user application tools. So that really ought to be at least one or two steps higher than the core description of the information. So you can see an end-to-end metadata implementation is pretty complicated, and it's not something that you do and then break for lunch. I mean, it's weeks and months of effort. So one of the things that we've been working on for the past few months is developing an internal workflow where we can provide consultation and support for the metadata process, as well as a flexible web tool to enable you to create objects, upload your objects to the repository, and create your metadata. We're fairly expert in metadata. Some of us have written books on it. We consult a lot. And so this is something that we have a lot of expertise in and that we're prepared to offer back to the records community. So this is our workflow management system that enables us to upload objects and data. And you can see we have all the different types of metadata, but not in a very user-friendly way. We've been working with Skills and had library students test our workflow management system. We also have built our repository with a grant from the Institute of Museum and Library Services, which gave us the money to buy $250,000 mass storage system. And we've been building the New Jersey Digital Highway, which is a statewide cultural heritage information portal. And we've had museums and libraries and historical societies and archives, large and small, around the state using our tool. And based on that, we've made a number of changes. We've identified that there are two types of users, the administrator and the metadata creator, and we're totally rewriting it from the point of view of the user. You can see a first-time user identifies their role, and then they can go through a tutorial, but always it's in a separate window, and they can use both the tutorial side-by-side with actually using WMS or workflow management system, which we've made simpler and simpler. So the next critical piece is collections. And we have for RU4 a 3-year collection development plan. We're really wanting to focus on primary research products that are not that readily identifiable and reusable right now, such as data sets that are produced as a byproduct of research, multimedia research products, the video, audio, and images that you produce, your lab notebooks, things like that. So we want to focus on research products that you wouldn't otherwise necessarily discover. One reason we want to focus on that is we have done a really good job, I think, with our data model, so we can add the kind of context pretty readily that's needed to make those things useful. Information can be very dangerous taken out of context. You really need to know what the context was, you need to know where something is in its stage of curation. There's a lot you need to know, and we think we build a data model that lets people pretty easily maintain that information. We also want to look at the resources created by administrators and publishers at Rutgers that have research value beyond that administering department, and then significant special collections from our libraries. We have the Institute of Jazz Studies, we have a lot of New Jerseyana political papers, et cetera, in our archives. So this is you can search our community repository right now. We have 3 collections right now, the New Jersey Digital Highway, our general collection. We've done some experimental work with digitizing some brittle books and other things, and our special collections. And that's just the New Jersey Digital Highway, which you can get to from our website. So for publishing, one of the things we're doing is we're trying to start developing some tools for robust and sustainable digital publishing workflows. And right now we've done 2 things and we've got another one that's kind of in the works. We're working on electronic theses and dissertations in collaboration with the graduate school in New Brunswick, and then we want to expand that to other graduate schools. I think the project team did a really cool job. They took the form that every PhD or master's candidate must fill out, and they put it online. So the student still needs to print it out after they filled it in so that they can sign off on it. But all of that information is captured as metadata that's used later to describe the thesis and dissertation. So we took information that graduate students must fill out anyway that they're used to filling out, and we made it an online form that feeds directly into our metadata. As an example of trying to, you know, really understand the workflow of whatever we're working with, and, you know, just, you know, incorporate that workflow. We also have an electronic journal publishing tool that supports peer review, indexing, and archiving. And we're working right now, we have a basic web archiving tool that maintains file structure and the different files to create a permanent snapshot of websites. What we want to do is make that automated with a crawler so we can go out and crawl websites on a schedule. And this is one of our journals, Pragmatic Case Studies in Psychotherapy. So for research and teaching, we want to work on our tools, and that's what we're doing right now. Our workflow management system, we're talking about developing a tool, possibly as a center of excellence, for a digital depot that allows us to receive and sort of an intelligent UPS for, where UPS stands for United Parcel Service, not uninterruptible power supply, for us to work with large data sets or even small data sets where you set up parameters once and that dictates to us how to handle your data from then on. Like if it's a website, it tells us, you know, crawl it every month or crawl it when we send an alert to you that we've made significant changes. And then document it in a manifest that says this is the version from this date, this is the version from that date, so that I can easily find my previous versions when I need them. So it would be that level of information that people would fill out once, and then that would reside at the depot, and every time your data comes, we'll follow that information. We also offer guidance. We have resources already available that give you guidance on the best practices right now for digital standards. We're creating data that's faithful to the analog original. We have a lot of guidance on metadata, an area of particular expertise for us. We have some equipment to create high-end digital objects. We've got a large format digital camera at the Alexander Library, and we just are getting ready to expend $55,000 on a high-end video encoder. We're working on our business model, and we're trying, you know, it was easier before Governor Secorthine's announcements, but we're trying to avoid this pay-by-the-drink business model. We're trying to develop flexible course services, participating grants. We've got a couple of grant opportunities with a couple of departments at Rutgers. And we're trying to just integrate repository services into our repertoire. I manage both digital library initiatives and technical services. Before we even got started on this, we did a major workflow analysis. We outsource a lot of what we do. I was able to divert three positions, existing positions so far, to the repository. So we're not seeing this as an add-on, but as a way of doing our business differently and redirecting our staff with that aim in mind. So this is the website. You're welcome to visit it. You can search our collections that we have to date. There's lots of information that can help you understand different pieces of cyber infrastructure. And, you know, as I say, we're trying to meet our four core needs of preservation, collections, publishing, research, and teaching. We hope to go live with the WMS in September and enable you to start adding projects. If you want us to do programming to build tools, then we would need to talk grants or something of that nature. But to just add objects and collections like the state libraries, museums, and archives are doing is something you'll be welcome to do. And you'll be able to say that to granting agencies that you're using a trusted repository architecture. We use the Fedora repository, and I think most granting agencies would say that that what we've done is designed to very high standards. And I speak with some assurance because I've reviewed grants for Marianne Scott at DOE. I've reviewed so often for the NSF. I also have my own office there. So I know what they're looking for, and I think we're meeting or exceeding any standards that they might set. So that's my presentation. Do we have any questions? Yes.
When you're capturing the images, what are you using? Are you using like a deja vu or something?
something like that?
No, we capture, oh, when you, he asked what we capture our images in. We have two separate types of images. We capture a digital master, which is done according to standards that have either been set by the library community or that we're setting in the absence of existing standards. And so we're capturing digital images at TIFF images in what's called 3,000 ppi on the long end, or what comes out to approximately 600 dots per inch, which we are, or pixels per inch, however you prefer to say it. And then we convert that automatically to a piece of software called Pipestream, which is part of the WMF, into Deja Vu for images, into JPEGs, and then if it's a document, into Deja Vu and PDF. So these are we choose access formats based on, are they giving us good fidelity and are they easy to read? What we'll be doing for videos, since there's no standard yet, and I'm involved in the emerging standards for digital video, and there's some promising ones coming along, but they don't exist yet. We'll actually be doing that as uncompressed. So that'll be 1080i uncompressed. So we're digitizing to very high standards. That's part of maintaining it to the long term. Any other questions? Well, thank you very much, and we encourage you to get involved with our youth board. I have